Classic Car and Driver is brought to you by WyoTech, a premier technical training experience.
John Thornley and Sid Enever are the men responsible for the development of MG's B model. Their work on MG's successful land speed car, the EX181 in 1959, produced many ideas that were incorporated into the B's design. After 3 years of development in Abingdon, England, the MGB arrived in the U.S. in 1962 and was an immediate success.
Look at the MG phenomenon in the United States, and that really, I think, more than any other kind of car, helped get America going, start America's love affair with sports cars. But of course, compared to contemporary American cars, they were light and they were small and they felt nimble, and so it was a refreshing change of pace.
But the MGB change of pace was not what purists thought was a real sports car. It was not at all like the car it replaced. The MGA had been in production since 1955, assembled in traditional body-on-frame construction with a Spartan interior, a canvas top, and side curtains to keep out the rain.
What I feel like you get from driving the MGA is you have the openness. It's like you're out in the world even though you're driving along with it, but you don't really get into a more comfortable cabin until you get into the MGB.
MG's parent company, British Leyland, felt the B's comfort would be the key to more sales in the U.S., but the change to unibody construction brought an additional benefit. Without a separate chassis, the floor pan could be lower, which made room for big Americans with a growing interest in small British roadsters. And all this new interior space was something my predecessors quickly picked up on, writing, "The unit-constructed body shell allows more legroom than a 7-footer will need." But the biggest departure from traditional British motoring was the addition of roll-up windows. Purists hated them. Americanized as it was, the original MGBs were sporty. We got 0 to 60 times of just under 11 seconds from the 1.8-liter four-cylinder engine. With twin SU carbs, the overhead valve 4 made 94 horses and powered the 2,000-pound car to a top speed of 103 miles per hour in fourth gear with the electric overdrive engaged.
You flick a switch on the dash, and you're instantly into third and a half, and then you're into fourth gear, and then you're in fourth and a half. So you essentially have six gears.
The V rode on independent front suspension, with leaf springs locating a live axle in the rear. Braking was drums in the rear, but disc brakes were standard in front, 3 years before the Corvette first got discs. But the success of the B model seemed to lull British Leyland into a false sense of security. The GT Coupe appeared in 1965, but no other changes were made to the MGB for more than 11 years, until the government ordered a change. Beginning in 1974, imported cars had to comply with new federal safety and emission regulations, but British Leyland didn't have the money to design a new model. So, ugly black rubber crash bumpers appeared front and rear. The suspension was raised up to meet the mandatory bumper height, and emission controls choked the power. 0 to 60 times climbed to more than 14 seconds. Not very sporting. But still, British Leyland made no attempt to solve the problems, letting their MGB stumble on with decreasing sales for 5 more years. By 1980, it was too late to revive the B's image and performance. The end finally arrived in October, 18 years after the first modern roadster arrived in the U.S. So it's the early cars we now remember as a mixture of sporting performance and civilized comfort. Cars that are now classic car and driver.